never forget through all the pain and the sweat. The two men deal with me yet. I got to keep pressing, got to keep pressing on. You're never forget.
Grace to you, family.
Hello, everybody. Thank you once again for joining in with us tonight. We have a special treat. You got something you want to share tonight, right?
Yes, yes. Kind of a continuance from last week.
Okay. Before you get into that, let me thank everyone for liking and sharing, for sowing a seed. Also, I want to thank everybody that sent me the email information. Please be paying attention to your inbox because I'm going to send you some details coming up this week. You will not be disappointed, so watch out for that.
Okay.
What you want to take us into tonight?
I want to take. I'm not going to be long, but the Lord has just been giving me different types of titles and to go by, different things to study. And this is what the Lord dropped in my spirit. This is the title.
Okay.
There's a lot of life left in that casket, and I'm going to be coming from Luke 7 and 11, and it reads as such: Now it happened the day after that he went into a city called Nain, and many of his disciples went with him in a large crowd. And when he came near the gate of the city, behold, a dead man was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and a large crowd from the city was with her. The Lord has really been putting on my heart, young men. Mm-hmm. And right here in this story, we're looking at a young man who was the only son of his mother. Mm-hmm. And so as the Lord dropped it in my spirit, I began to meditate on it. And I was like, God, what are you trying to say? So then God began to open the scripture up to me and began to bring things to my remembrance. Mm-hmm. And I can remember at one time I was asking God, what is going on with our children? Mm-hmm. What is going on with the children of the saints? Mm-hmm. And the Holy Ghost gave me, you know, revelation, just enlightened the eyes of my understanding. He said, the same thing that's going on with the children is the same thing that was going on with you.
Yeah.
He was basically saying that they are dead in their sins. See, through the eyes of God, even though we're not in a natural casket, mm-hmm. we can be in a spiritual casket because we are in our sins. Mm-hmm. And so the young man in this story, he was in a natural casket, but the Lord wants us to see it in the realm of the spirit, mm-hmm. and understand that some of our children are living in a spiritual casket. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So he took me to Ephesians 2 and 1. It says, once you were dead because of your disobedience, in your many sins, you used to live in sin, mm-hmm. talking about me and you, yeah. just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. Mm-hmm. All of us used to live that way, mm-hmm. following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger, get this, just like everyone else. Mm-hmm. But this is why they call the word of God the good news. Mm-hmm. But God mm-hmm. is so rich in mercy, yeah. and he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, mm-hmm. he gave us life when he raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Mm-hmm. For he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in heavenly realms because we are united with Christ. Mm-hmm. So when he gave me the title, there's a lot of life left in the casket. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of young men that are living in sin, just like I was living in sin, mm-hmm. and you were living in sin. Mm-hmm. But what the Lord is saying is there's a lot of life inside of that casket. Mm-hmm. What he's saying is that there's a lot of goals, there's a lot of dreams, there's a calling that he has on the life of these young people, yeah. but we don't see it right now because they are living in their sins. Mm-hmm. And get this, it says, When the Lord saw her, get this, he had compassion on her, mm-hmm. and said to her, do not weep. And the word that I want to bring to light right now and just expound on a little bit is that word compassion. Mm-hmm. That word compassion, when you define it, when you look at it, it means to have the bowels yearn. It means to be moved by one's bowels. Get this. For the bowels were thought to be the seat of love and pity. And what I want to ask the people of God right now, in your bowels, is there love and pity? Is there mercy? Is there forgiveness in your bowels? See, this is what we must understand about compassion. Compassion moves first internally, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. then looks for a way to express itself externally. Let me say that one more time. Compassion moves first internally, then it looks for a way to express itself externally. And what we must understand as the people of God, especially mm-hmm. us that are, call ourselves minister, mm-hmm. we must have the same compassion as the one that has called us into the ministry. Mm-hmm. The Bible said that Jesus had compassion for her. But the truth of the matter is today, there's a lot of people that are operating in the gifts of God, but have no compassion for the people. There's a lot of people that are prophesying, but have no compassion. There's a lot of people that are laying hands on people, but have no compassion. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of people that are singing and dancing and preaching the word of God, but have no compassion for the people that they are preaching to. Get this. In Matthew 9:36, it says, but when he saw the multitudes, we're talking about Jesus, he was moved with compassion. See, compassion causes you to act. If you say that you have compassion, but you never move, I question if you got compassion. Mm-hmm. It says he was moved with compassion for them because they were weary and scattered like sheep having no shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest mm-hmm. to send laborers into his harvest. Now, if you are one of those laborers that have been called into the harvest to serve Christ, I want to ask you today, check yourself, yeah. check your walk, and are you operating in compassion? Mm-hmm. Do you love people? And do you not only love people, but are you moved by compassion to be a blessing to people? So how is it that Jesus, mm-hmm, who operated in compassion and told the disciples to pray for laborers, that once we, now that we are in the field mm-hmm. or we're in the harvest ministering, he prayed it out of his compassion. That means we should be a reflection of that prayer and we should operate out of compassion. But the truth of the matter is, some only show compassion to those that have been afflicted by the same things that they have suffered. Mm-hmm. Let me say that one more time. Some only show compassion to those that have been afflicted by the same things that they have suffered. Mm-hmm. See, when it's not your child, you don't show compassion. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. When it's not your job that was lost, you don't show compassion. When it's not your marriage, you don't show compassion. When it's not your repossession, you don't show compassion. We must be compassionate people if we're to truly do what it is that God has called us to do in the earth realm. Mm-hmm. The Bible says, rejoice with them that do rejoice and to weep with them that weep. Yeah. But the truth of the matter is, some of us only show compassion for those that have been conflicted with some of the same things that we have been conflicted with. Mm-hmm. Once one person has a divorce, then you go through a divorce. Now you understand yeah. what it feels yeah. to be afflicted by that situation. So now you're showing compassion. No, mm-hmm. no. Mm-hmm. You should have showed compassion from the get-go. Mm-hmm. Let me continue on what the Lord has shared with me. Verse 13, let me read it one more time. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion. We must understand that compassion is a characteristic of God. I know you've been praying to God and you're wondering if God is hearing you or does God even care. But the Bible says it right here. He had compassion on her. The same way that God has compassion on her, he has compassion on us. Mm-hmm. Get this. He told her, do not weep. I don't know who you are out there, but I want you to know the Lord is saying, do not weep. The Lord has seen you weeping. The Lord has seen you crying, and the Lord has heard your prayers. It says in verse 14, then he came and touched the open coffin. What does the coffin represent? The coffin represents the situation. Mm-hmm. The Bible said he touched the coffin. I believe by the Spirit of God that he's going to touch the situation that your son is dealing with. Mm-hmm. It says, and those who carried him stood still. And he said, young man, I say to you, arise. So he was dead. So he who was dead sat up and began to speak. And he presented him to his mother. God is not only going to touch the situation, but I believe by the Spirit of God that he's going to speak directly to your son. He's going to call him to arise. And I believe by the Spirit of God that your son is going to sit up and he's going to begin to speak. When I say speak, he's going to testify of the goodness of the Lord. I want to say this prayer before I get up out of here. The Lord put it in my spirit to write it down and let me share it just real quick before we go. Mm-hmm. You have something?
Well, I just want, while you was talking about that, that scripture came to me, but God commended his love toward us,
right,
that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And for so long, I read that scripture only thinking about myself and how God loved me even when I was in my sin.
Right.
But now when I read that scripture, I get more out of it, and it reminds me to love and show others the compassion that God loved and showed me while I was in sin.
Wow.
So although they may not be where I think they should be, or they may not be living the life that I know God wants to call them into living,
right,
I'm able to show a measure of compassion and love and patience for them,
right,
because God showed that to me.
That's right. That's
and so that just really reminded me of that scripture, that God commended his love towards
us. Right.
That while we were living in what we were in, he died for us.
That's right.
So while he did that for us, while we were in the state that we were in,
right,
that's the same level of compassion and grace and patience we should show other people.
Today's key word is compassion.
Yeah.
And what God is saying, the same thing that it took to bring us out is the same thing that it's going to take to bring our children
out. That's right.
And that is his son, Jesus.
Yes.
Now, let me go into this prayer. And I wrote it like this. Father God, we pray for every young man across this city, state, and nation who is dead in his trespasses and sins. We pray for all of those who are walking according to the course of this world. Mm-hmm. May they no longer fulfill the lust of the flesh and of the mind. We decree and declare that the Adamic nature is being overturned in their lives.
Mm-hmm.
They will no longer be a child of wrath, nor will they associate with the children of wrath.
Mm-hmm.
May they be quickened with Christ and sit with him in heavenly places. We pray, Father, that you show them the same compassion that you showed the widow in Nain. As Jesus touched the casket, we're asking that you touch every situation, regardless of how great or how small they are. We're asking, Father, that you not only touch the situation, but that you call these men to arise.
Okay.
And when you call them, Father, may they arise, set up, and come out of gangs. May they come out of addictions.
Mm-hmm.
May they come out of mental illness. May they come out of cycles that keep them going in and out of jail. May they come out of false religions.
Yeah.
May they come out of deceptions. And may they come out of the doctrines of devils. And may they come out of the hand of the enemy. I pray, Father God, that you sober their minds, Father God, that they may receive your engrafted word, which is able to save their souls.
Mm-hmm.
Restore, God, and return them to their mothers and fathers.
Mm-hmm.
And as the widow's son spoke, may they speak and testify of your kindness, and may they follow your word to keep their ways pure.
Yes.
I pray that this has been a blessing to you. If you would like a copy of the prayer, just message us and we'll make sure that we get it to you. The Lord has really just put young men on my heart. He just put them on our heart. I know, we've been touched with a few young men that we know that have passed away way before their time. But, you know, we want the families to know, all families to know, that in the spiritual realm, we're locking arms with you, and we're praying for you. We're praying with you for your son. You're not alone. And I believe that God is hearing our prayer. Not only is God hearing our prayers, but God is moving on our prayers. Mm-hmm. Look for the manifestation. God is going to touch the coffin, and he's going to call these young men forward. He's not going. He's already calling them forward. We believe it by the Spirit of God. I pray that this has been a blessing to you. And until we see you next time, my name is Corey.
I'm Sean.
And we just want to bless you and thank y'all for tuning in. Be blessed.
So you can't give up on life just because you take a couple of blows. You go through some trials and tragedy. Things on all